October 7th, they will have a week of visits in Washington, D.C. Then we will go to Early House, which is like a great ship. We'll all be enclosed in there. No one can go anywhere.
It's 3,000 acres.
It's 3,000 acres, a great and wonderful estate for co-creation. Then the Soviet delegation with some of the Americans will go to New York City, where they will be hosted by another committee. And among the things they will do is see Cats on Broadway, arranged by Alexander Cohen. And also they will go to the United Nations, where a panel will receive the delegation, and we will communicate to that panel the joint projects that have come out of these three events. And it is our intention to make this a true beginning of an annual Soviet-American Citizen Summit on innovation. It is a parliament of innovators of the heart, the mind, and the spirit that we are bringing together here. And it is through these innovations that we believe the new era and the new epoch is being created now. So we thank you, and we look forward to this event with great anticipation. Thank you.
Я сейчас попрошу Раму Вернон, чтобы она сказала несколько слов о тех наших гостях, американцах, которые приехали сюда. Пожалуйста.
Henry asked if I would introduce some of the delegation, which is unexpected because we had thought it would take too long. We cannot introduce you all, although I feel that you're all deserving of introduction, but you'll be introduced as the week goes on. A few of our people, I'd like to point out, and those of you, when you are introduced, if you could just stand up so they'll know who you are, is the past president of Women in Films, who worked with Carol Ballard on the movies The Black Stallion and Never Cry Wolf, and that is Barbara Parker. And one of the co-producers, and Charles Nims. I'm sure he's here. And that is the flutist who is well known for his inside the Taj Mahal, who gave concerts here in the Soviet Union, and they have to turn people away one time. That's Paul Horn. And tomorrow we have Robert Chartoff arriving, who is including Rocky IV and The Right Stuff, The Raging Bull, and many others. And we do have the film Rocky IV with us. And tomorrow also, just hold applause until after you've seen the movie. And tomorrow, Chris Christopherson is arriving with his two children and his band of 16 members. We would like to introduce our guest speaker of the morning, which I will let Barbara do.
Yes,
I'm very honored to introduce Sam Keen.
We must wait for technology. In which we learn that whenever particles were whirling around, that our very act of looking at those particles changed the place those particles were. The artists had told us that, the impressionists had told us that long ago, that perception changes things. That the world isn't just out there, but that in a very large measure, we make the world by the way we see it. Only in politics has the world remained the world of the dinosaurs. Only in politics do we still live in a world that is pre-Copernican. Each nation believes that the sun revolves around it. and that the way it sees the world is the way the world is. It may be that this conference indeed will be the beginning of a new era in politics. Because to my recollection, it is the first time any two nations who are in some sense enemies have met together and agreed to talk about the idea of an enemy or the image of an enemy. Merely agreeing to speak about images of the enemy is a confession that perhaps you are not as we see you, and we are not as you see us, but that we make each other by the way that we see each other. That in the beginning is the image. In the beginning is the metaphor. That poetry comes before fact. And that to change the world most profoundly is to change, first of all, the way that we see that world. The poet T.S. Eliot said a long time ago, "Between the image and the reality falls the shadow." And so this morning, what I want to do is, first of all, I want to take you on a retrospective journey back into the past. Santayana, the great philosopher, once said that those who will not remember their history are doomed to repeat it. And so the first thing that we have to do is to look at the way that we have seen each other, with the recognition that that's only the way we saw each other, not the way we were. And so when I show you this collection of mine of dirty pictures, what your poet Yevtushenko called warnography, images that do incite us to violence, you must remember that I'm showing you only the way that we saw each other, never the way that we were. But perhaps if we have the courage, first of all, to look that way, then we can take these glasses off of our eyes. We can strip ourselves of some of the stereotypes. Paradoxically, the first act of change is to do nothing. In the United States, at railroad crossings, we have a sign, and that sign says, "Stop, look, and listen." So let's begin by that. The political cartoon or the propaganda poster is the way to the royal road to the unconscious of the body politic. What I show you now is our dreams of each other. Perhaps more accurately, our nightmares of each other. The message is, it's time to wake up. Communism predates the Russian Revolution. This slide is from Thomas Nast in the 1880s, is already seeing communism as a threat to everything which is sacred to the capitalist system. The very notion, so our systems are based upon two systematically different ideas. For communism, surplus value is stolen from the workers, whereas for capitalism, the surplus value which creates capital is the basis that for all that is sacred in our system. And so here we see already before the Soviet Union is a communist country, that we are very much threatened by the notion that capital is to be slain. And here from Thomas Nast, the same thing, that if all things are held in common, our nightmare was that not only would property be held in common, but even the women would be held in common. You notice that up in his top hat, there's a little sign, and that says, free love. And already in the 1920s, Bolshevism, and we perceived Bolshevism as they were rude and crude and unattractive, barbarians breaking through the door of civilization. And the greatest threat of all, one which has always been there, this from the 1930s, from 1930, the charge that communism is atheistic and therefore against all that we see as holy, a charge which we still hear the echoes of in the rhetoric of evil empires and godless empires, and still very much a view which animates the extreme right wing in our country. By the 1930s also, when the Soviet Union was in economic trouble, we began to gloat and to say, look, you see, you've now killed the goose of capital, and now you want our tractors, and now you want our technological know-how, and see, you want to revive the goose that laid the golden egg. But then, of course, came the war and a marriage of convenience finally between the Soviet Union and the United States to battle the Germans after the British had capitulated in Munich and the Soviets in the non-aggression pact, and suddenly we found ourselves on the same side. This particular leaflet, which really is a kind of dramatization of our meeting of our troops on the Elbe, was dropped over Japan and shows a perception that we had then of our Soviet brothers and sisters, and of the unity of the two countries, and of the equality of size. Although I must say that in the United States, the perception was always that we won the war, and that we bore the brunt of the war, and if it weren't for our lend-lease, that the Soviets would not have won. And we don't know very much about how long the Soviets were in the war and how much they had taken the brunt of the war against the Nazis before we entered. That's not, I think, popular knowledge. Already after the war, already by 1946, however, the Iron Curtain begins to fall, and we see the beginning of a systematic enmity again against the Soviet Union and fear of it. And all of our Marshall Plan and rebuilding of Europe and the beginning of the European Community and NATO are response to communism sowing chaos in Europe. We're the doctors who are going to help to remedy this situation. In back of this, as the Cold War begins, is always this kind of fear that any time we hear a peace proposal from the Soviet Union, that it's merely a mask, it's a diversion, it's a trick to get us to disarm, and that the single unerring intent of the Soviet Union is to conquer. And there's the built-in notion that the class struggle inevitably ends toward the triumph of socialism, and that we will bury you merely because history is so constituted by that dialectic. And that far from being a country which is ruled by the people, it's a new form of imperialism. And here the Cold War showing what we perceived as the annexations to the territory of the Soviet Union. And we began then again to see Stalin in the image of Hitler. And you'll notice as we come to the Soviet images that this is a little trick that we play back and forth on each other. It's who can pin the Hitler badge on who. Or here with the Hungarian, perhaps there was after the war no event that shocked us so much as the putting down of the Hungarian Revolution, 1956. And so the perception that this, we go back here, this was actually a very small group in the United States, but I think it shows a certain kind of archetypal understanding of the Soviet Union, of communism as the dragon. And it follows from that, of course, that we are to be the dragon slayers. We are to be the heroes who kill the mythic beast. However, the conflict was seen just even from the side of England from Punch, not so much as a conflict with demons, but as a real just power conflict. And largely between equals. With the building of the Berlin Wall, it was for us a dramatic, concrete confession that the system was not working, because if it was working so well, and if you were indeed building the workers' paradise, then why was the wall to keep them in? The next large crisis with the Cuban Missile Crisis, 1962. The Kennedy had entered office with the fear by many that he would be too soft on communism. It was an assumption of Khrushchev and others that he was very pushable. And with the missile crisis, there became a new kind of rhetoric in Washington. And that rhetoric was that nobody could get elected to the American presidency without appearing tough on communism, tough on communism. We had to be rough and tough and hard to bluff. John Wayne came to the White House and stayed from then on. And we saw there that this confirmed one of the principles that we've always held toward the Soviet Union, that Soviets only respect strength. And that finally, if you make a concession, they do not make a concession in return, that you have to hit them very hard to get their attention. And here, finally, Khrushchev retreated and Castro cries. One of the things that we always have to remember in looking at that United States opinion is that there's always a jester. There's always somebody who doesn't go along with official line. There's always somebody who, how do we say, farts in church, or says no, a plague on both of your houses, who says you're both playing stupid games. And so there you see really a much more, in some ways, accurate and non-ideological portrayal of the arms race. But with the beginning then of the 60s and our involvement in Vietnam, we again saw the communist snake as everywhere gobbling up the world, and the Kennan doctrine of containment became the dominant kind of theme, that communism is this kind of vicious snake or is a disease, and anywhere it comes up, we must immediately combat it. No matter what corner of the world, we'll rush there so long as it is identified as communist. But again, the politician, the cartoonist, who is really a prophet and not a propagandist, and who looks at them both and says, look, how do we get out of this? Both of us have this problem. How do we let them down? How do we stop? And we all know how to run an arms race, but we don't know how to stop running. But again, this is interesting. Let me go back one, because you see that is by Oliphant, who there says, as it were, a plague on both of your houses. But when it comes to looking at the Mideast, he's right back to saying, aha, it's the Soviets who are creating mischief in the Near East by arming the Arabs. Again, ignoring our complicity in that region. And here we had more than one laugh at you when the pretensions of the strength, and we had to bail you out as we regularly did with our wheat. Something that many people weren't happy about because you got much too good a bargain. When it was suggested that maybe you should pay the actual going market price for the wheat that we sold you, some wit in the Soviet Union said, we'll do it if you'll pay us the price that we should have had for Alaska. By 1974, though, the beginning of a new era, the era of detente, and a new thaw, a new love affair between the Russian bear and the American eagle. and there were high hopes. There were high hopes that already in the 70s that we rode in on with the Helsinki confirmation, but many people saw that as another betrayal like Yalta, because we did not believe that you would live up to the human rights promises of the Helsinki Convention. And always again, this a kind of right-wing view of the Soviet Union, that the Soviets have spies everywhere, that everywhere you go, there's spies and the CIA and everything else. And of course, one of our myths is that everywhere we go here, that we're bugged, that our rooms are bugged in the hotel, you know. And one day I got up in the hotel and I said, I demand to be heard, you know, speaking, get me a bug, please, somebody listen. It's, if this were all right, you would have to have about 40 million people to listen to all the conversations, but we somehow have that myth there.